Thank you for joining us for an Industry Insiders webinar, part of a webinar series put on through the Office of Alumni Engagement at the college. My name is Pam Persichetti, and I am the Alumni Engagement Officer at the college. So thanks again for joining us, taking some time out of your day and tuning in. We have a really fun webinar today with Tom Armenti and Kevin Gabauer. They're going to talk about startup business and their Fat Shack story. We have a charismatic presentation, so I will try to get through the introductions fairly quickly to give them enough time to share their story. I do want to mention that we will have a question and answer segment at the conclusion. And so if you'd like to enter any questions into the chat, we encourage that, but we also encourage, since we are in meeting format, to ask your questions live today. I know our presenters would love to engage live with you folks, so we encourage that at the end. And I also want to give a quick plug to our School of Business Entrepreneurship Club, who is in the audience today. They helped us promote this webinar, and hopefully some of them will have some questions for Tom and Kevin. So thank you guys for joining and for helping us promote this. So I will do a quick introduction of our two hosts today. And I don't want to get too caught up in the details, because a lot of their presentation is in fact their story and their journey from college all the way to where they're at now. So a quick overview of Tom and Kevin. They are 2009 graduates of the School of Business. They became friends at TCNJ. They are also members of the fraternity Phi Kappa Psi. Soon after graduating, Tom decided to start a sandwich business. And he found a means of doing so by utilizing a shared store location in Ewing, New Jersey. And through his connections at TCNJ and through some of his frat brothers, he was able to spread the word around campus of Fat Shack and the company that he was beginning. Eventually, Tom saw an industry opening to grow his business out in Colorado. So he did that, and he moved out there to expand upon the business. Couple of years later, Kevin kind of switched gears and joined him and became co-founder of the Fat Shack franchising company, which it is known as today. The two have now been best friends for 15 years. They've been co-business partners for 8 years. Like I said, they have a really fun story to share with us today that spans back to their time in undergrad. And everything they've been able to grow since then. So it's a great story. We're going to start, before I turn it over to them, with a couple videos from their time on the reality hit TV series Shark Tank, which is really fun. So I'm going to share my screen and share those videos with you, and then we'll turn it over to Tom and Kevin.
Next up is a business that does not skimp on the good stuff.
What's up, guys? I'm Tom Armenti.
And I'm Kevin Gabauer, and we're from Fort Collins, Colorado.
We're seeking a $250,000 investment for a 7.5% stake in our company.
Sharks, picture the perfect healthy meal. Flakes of seaweed, sauteed in coconut oil, sprinkled with chia seeds, all resting on a bed of crisp green kale.
At our restaurant, we specialize in taking this perfectly healthy meal and throwing it right in the trash. We're the Fat Shack. Do we serve your favorite foods like French fries, chicken fingers, and mozzarella sticks? But we do it all on one sandwich.
No.
Yes,
no.
We're gonna start here with your French fries and your cheesesteak. Then we're gonna load it up with some chicken fingers, followed by some mozzarella sticks on there,
and then
some onion rings. It's still looking a little bit light. What do you think, Kev?
Jalapeno poppers.
Of course, yes. We've got jalapeno poppers.
Why not?
Throw those jalapeno poppers, and then we finish it off with tons and tons of our ooey, gooey sauce. Now, we're going to wrap this thing up nice and tight so we can serve it just like a normal sandwich. Now, that is what we call the perfect meal.
And sharks, we have plenty of other normal people food as well. Triple stack cheeseburgers, deep fried funnel cake bites. And the best part is we're open as late as 4 a.m. We have seen huge success with our concept, and we're committed to making our growth even bigger than our sandwiches. So sharks, who's ready to dig in and join the Fat Shack team?
Gotta try it.
Let's we got some samples. Some kale salad for you guys. No, just kidding.
Fat Shack.
How did he get that sandwich to look like
that? Sandwich?
We have small ones that range from like 700 to 800, and then bigger ones that get up to 2,000.
Okay, so we have another video of the deal being made. Let me jump to that one.
The reason it's that much, because it's a slow burn. And the real home run in all this isn't the franchise fee. So it's an exit, right?
Yeah.
And the challenge is that it's gonna take a lot of years. That's the catch 22. There's gotta be enough upside for all that I'd be investing.
I'll bring mine down to 17 as well.
Wow.
We would do a deal at 12%.
Oh, that's not exciting.
It's not enough. Okay, guys, it's decision time.
So, Mark, would you be willing to do $250,000 for 15% of the company? Can we call it right now? 15%.
Done
deal.
Great.
Let's do it.
Let's go get fat.
All right, guys. Appreciate it, baby. Appreciate
Thank you, Mark.
Good job, baby.
We're excited.
Oh, let's eat. The reason is that much.
All right, guys. Take it away.
Thanks, Pam. Thanks for sharing that video too. It's always kind of funny watching the son of the tank there. But you know, like Pam said, my name's Tom Armenti. You know, I'm the founder and current CEO and president of the Fat Shack, and Kev.
And I'm Kevin Gabauer, current CFO of the Fat Shack.
So yeah, we're gonna kind of take you guys back to the beginning, back in college, and you know, we're gonna work through kind of the whole Fat Shack story. And you know, then we're going to go into a couple key takeaways for you guys, just about business in general, you know, and kind of how it pertains to our story. And then we want to save plenty of time for question and answer, because I'm sure people have a lot of questions about the Shark Tank in general and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, we definitely want to make sure we've got time to hear from you guys. So, you know, as you're listening to us, like, please think of stuff that you want to ask. You know, we're good to hang on here a little bit later too, if anyone has questions. And like Pam said, you know, we like this meeting format, where, you know, we're totally awesome, excited for people to actually open up their mics and talk with us directly. So, you know, we're looking forward to that at the end of this. So anyway, just jumping back into it. So, you know, what you guys saw there, that was us filming the Shark Tank in 2018, but I'm gonna take it back about 10 years to 2008. So, you know, as Pam mentioned, Kevin and I were both students at TCNJ, both business majors and friends, and Phi Kappa Psi fraternity brothers. But you know, my story kind of starts a little bit even earlier than the Fat Shack. It was 2008, my junior year. And for those of you that are all business majors at TCNJ, you know that that's the summer that you're supposed to get an internship. For me, I played online poker my first couple years of college. I never really had a job. You know, I knew that I always wanted to start my own business. So, you know, junior year, summer hits and you're supposed to get an internship. I grew up in Ramsey, New Jersey. I was back home for the summer with a couple of my hometown friends. And yeah, we were trying to figure out ways to avoid getting those jobs. So, you know, we were sitting around trying to think of business ideas, and we knew that in Ramsey, New Jersey, there really wasn't much late night food. So luckily, one of my best friends, his dad actually owned a local deli there. And, you know, we kind of came up with the idea of, hey, let's try to open something late at night. That can serve this void that we've seen, you know, and then we started creating the menu. We went to his dad. He allowed us to operate out of his restaurant. And for anyone here that's from North Jersey, you might've heard of it. It was called Cars, C-A-R-S. You know, that was the first business that I founded with my buddies. You know, from there, that was the first time I ever worked in a kitchen. That was the first time I ever saw a fryer, figured out, you know, what I was doing. And, you know, I kind of ran that during my senior year. We ran it the summer after senior year. And then when I graduated, you know, me and my friend, we kind of decided, hey, I'm going to break off, do my own thing. You know, you can keep Cars, you know, and keep building that. And again, for those of you from North Jersey, he has two locations up there now, the one in Ramsey still and another one in Montclair. But, you know, it was at that point that I kind of ventured off on my own and decided that I was going to take this journey solo and create what is called the Fat Shack. So I went back down to my college campus house that, you know, I just lived there senior year, stayed on campus, and I started looking for restaurant spaces to build out, you know, this new concept, the Fat Shack down there. I very quickly found out that restaurants are extremely expensive. And, you know, I started looking for empty spaces, started getting quotes, $150,000, $175,000, you know, all this money that I didn't have. You know, I probably had about $10,000 or so to my name at that point that I hadn't lost playing online poker to date. So, you know, I was just trying to figure out how can I get creative, you know, how can I build this restaurant out? And I kind of thought back to, you know, what my friends and I did back in Ramsey and thought, you know, if this guy's dad was willing to allow us to operate out of his restaurant, you know, maybe there's somebody locally that'll do the same for me. So it was at that time that I approached a local bagel shop owner in Ewing, New Jersey, and him and I worked out a deal where I was going to come in and operate the Fat Shack at night. So he would run, you know, his 6 a.m. till 3 p.m. business, the bagel shop and the deli. And then I would come in and I'd run the Fat Shack from 6 p.m. until 4 in the morning, kind of doing the opposite schedule. So, you know, I was lucky that he was willing to work with me. And, you know, I was able to open the Fat Shack for about $5,000 total, just going out, buying the food, buying some heat lamps, you know, buying what I needed to get going. So, you know, as you'll learn throughout the story, I'm not much of a planner. You know, that's where Kevin comes in later. But for me, it was truly, you know, I made this deal with this guy. And then I went home for Christmas break, like I was a college student still. And then I came back 3 weeks later and just had this thing up and running. So, you know, I went around, handed menus out, you know, started spreading the word. And, you know, opening night, we were able to do over $2,000 in sales, you know, just in this bagel shop, you know, and I kind of sat there to myself thinking, what have I done? You know, this is insane. Like, I'm going to be stuck in this bagel shop for the rest of my life making these sandwiches. So you fast forward about a year, and I have family that lives out here in Loveland, Colorado, and they saw how successful the Fat Shack was doing. You know, everyone here knows TCNJ isn't the biggest school in the world. So when you go and you look at a place like Fort Collins, Colorado, where there's 30,000 students at CSU, you know, they convinced me that this would be a great place to start looking to expand the business. So in 2011, I ended up just kind of picking up and moving to Colorado. And moving to, you know, Loveland, which is right near Fort Collins near CSU, and opening the first full Fat Shack, you know, right there near CSU campus. So it was that time that, you know, I had to get back into it, start grinding like crazy, start building out the business. And, you know, that first year, I didn't really make any money. I had no idea what I was doing running a full restaurant at that point. But, you know, I was able to kind of start figuring it out. And, you know, my goal was always to try to build this concept into a franchising company. You know, build something big. So it was at that time that I realized, you know, again, with my, you know, my weakness of the organization and, you know, the planning side of it, you know, who did I know that could do that? And, you know, this is where Kevin Gabauer comes in. You know, he was that guy in college. We were in business class together. You know, he'd be the kind of guy we'd be on a group report. I'd say, hey, Kev, I'm going to play a poker tournament. You know, you finish the paper and I'll come back and we'll do the presentation together. You know, so it was always a perfect partnership from the very beginning. You know, so that's kind of where Kevin comes in, if you want to.
Yeah, that's funny because, yeah, Tom was the guy you didn't want to get partnered with for the class project, but you got stuck with it anyway. But yeah, to Tom's point, in contrast, you know, rather than doing a crazy restaurant business out of college, I had those internships sophomore, junior year. And then I had went right into corporate insurance right after graduation. So I took that traditional route that many of our other friends you know, had went to, and all the while I'd helped Tom with the insurance for the Fat Shack location that he had in Ewing and the one in Fort Collins. But then, you know, all the while I was kind of keeping up to date with what was going on, and him and I were working for, you know, at least a year prior to me, moving out to Colorado, just in the back end, organizing the business a little bit. So in 2012 in December, I had made a trip out to Colorado for the first time, you know, checked out the store and flew back to New Jersey, and a month or two later quit my job, which was obviously a very tough thing with, you know, the salary and benefits and, you know, get used to those paychecks coming in. And just in February 2013, I quit and we drove out to Colorado. And, you know, started in that Fort Collins store, like Tom had mentioned, you know, a lot of working long hours. We were organizing the business at that point. And, you know, doing a lot of new branding initiatives and making the menu simpler so that, you know, training of the staff was a lot easier. And yeah, the big thing too, just back then, you know, we were closing down the restaurant five nights a week, and Tom was in there making sandwiches. And, you know, the big struggle at first was to try to get Tom on board with, hey, like, you know, we got to start working on the business, not just in the business, for all these hours every day, and start getting deliberate on what we were looking to accomplish. And so soon after that, we were looking in a nearby town, Boulder, Colorado, the home of CU. And, you know, that was our next big opportunity that we thought, where if we could open a store there, we could try to prove the concept further. And so we found a spot in Boulder in the fall of 2013. And in October, we opened the doors to our Boulder store, and we used that store as a proof of concept, basically. So we treated that business, we had it paying royalties back to our parent company to see how, you know, see how that all worked and see what it would all look like. And then from there, you know, the Boulder store was a success. We were, you know, busy from day one, which is cool because for those of you who know Boulder, Boulder's a very, very healthy city. You know, Colorado is one of the healthiest states in the country, and Boulder is probably the epicenter of that health craze. And we are not involved in that health craze by any means. So that was really cool to see the business take off in a town like Boulder. And from there, we started really getting serious about, you know, the franchising element and picking it up from there.
So, you know, at that point now we kind of had the four columns of the Boulder store as, you know, good proofs of concept. And, you know, this is when we really, you know, decided that we wanted the franchise, you know, we wanted to build this thing out. So at this point, you know, we started working, and, you know, we'll get into it a little bit more in detail when we get into the key takeaways, but we started working with some people from the inside. So there was people that started off working for us as delivery drivers and kitchen workers, you know, guys that we knew had the grind and had the mentality, but not necessarily the financial means. So, you know, we figured out ways to partner with these guys and get them into their own Fat Shacks. So in 2015, we opened the first franchise in Denver. It was near DU University there, which is, you know, a little bit of a smaller school, but definitely, you know, pretty wild nightlife. And, you know, everybody there is going out pretty late. And again, kind of took off right away when we opened that first franchise. And soon after, we opened the second franchise in Thornton, Colorado, and then the third franchise in Greeley, Colorado. So at that point, you know, now we're sitting on five locations, two that we own, and, you know, these three franchise locations. And, you know, it was at this time that we just kind of buckled down, figured out what do we need to fix? What do we need to change? You know, how can we keep building this franchising system? So we kind of took a year just to hone everything in. And then at that point started, you know, taking more people from the inside plus people from the outside and building the franchising, the network of franchises. So at that point, you know, then we were able to open, you know, a few more in Colorado. We ended up getting a store or two down in Texas, and some people that had eaten our food in Colorado and loved it so much were from Bellingham, Washington, and they wanted to, you know, move back to their hometown and open the Fat Shack up in Washington. So, you know, we started kind of spreading out and building this franchise system, you know, and you fast forward to 2018, and now we're sitting on 11 restaurants total at this point. And this is when I got the infamous text from my cousin, who, you know, just happened to let me know that Shark Tank was coming down to Denver for an open casting call. Now, Shark Tank, you know, I'm sure a lot of you guys have watched it, especially if you're business majors. You know, it was something that I had watched from the very beginning in 2008, 2009 when it started. And, you know, you're always watching and thinking, what can you do? You know, did this person do wrong? What did Mr. Wonderful roast this person for? You know, and you kind of take these bits and pieces as you're building your business too and learn from it. So it was always an amazing thing to us, the Shark Tank phenomenon. You know, we had talked about going on before, but we were always at that point where, you know, we wouldn't have even known what to do with the money, even if we got a deal. But at this point, 11 locations is when we kind of thought, you know what, like this might be the time. So Kevin was actually back in New Jersey at the time. And, you know, this thing was coming up in a few days. I just heard about it. So in my typical fashion, you know, I just called Kevin and said, hey man, like there's this open casting call. What do you think if I just go down there and go for it? And he's like, yeah, like, why not? Let's give it a shot. So, you know, I literally just drove down to Denver with my wife, had a Fat Shack shirt on, bunch of Fat Shack menus, had no preparation whatsoever. You know, she's sitting there with me. Hey, do you want to practice? Do you want to do something? I'm like, let me just go. Let me just vibe it out and see what happens. So I walk into this room with a producer and just kind of start telling the story, start talking about it, giving a little pitch. And he luckily was from the East Coast, you know, had heard of fat sandwiches and Yeah, we'll talk about that. I saw a question about Rutgers. You know, that is a big thing in New Jersey. You know, this is where we believe the fat sandwich was invented, in Jersey. There's a fight between Jersey and Florida. But we believe Jersey is it. So, you know, he had seen these fat sandwiches before, and I was lucky that he kind of knew, you know, the whole deal and was super excited about the concept. And, you know, at this point, you're in there talking to a producer, and, you know, they sit everybody down afterwards and they tell you all, listen, Shark Tank, you know, this is harder to get into than Harvard, is what they say. They say there's 40,000 applications every year, and they're only putting 100 on the air, or they're only filming 100, 120. And then from there, only 2/3 of them even air. So they just consistently told us, you know, just, you're probably never going to hear from us again. Just understand that, you know, you might get an email, but you most likely will never hear from us again. So you leave there kind of up in the air, you know, how did it go? What's going to happen? Thinking, you know, they told you you're not going to hear from them. That's probably it. And what do you know, a week later, you know, you get an email from somebody saying, hey, congratulations, you're moving on to the next round. Here's about 100 pieces of paper for you to fill out, and waivers and all this kind of stuff. You know, so then obviously Kevin and I start filling this paperwork out, and we have to send a video through to them, you know, of us doing our pitch. And, you know, now we're actually in communication with producers directly, executive producers. And, you know, all along the way, they just keep saying, you're not going to hear from us. You're not going to hear from us. You know, just you'll probably never get another call again. And we just keep getting these calls. So it just keeps kind of moving along. So, you know, at this point now, we get another call. They're flying us out to LA to film, you know, in the actual Shark Tank. So, Kev, I'll let you take it.
Yeah, from there. And so this is when it pivots. Then we kind of think, okay, like, how are we actually going to do this? They say there's a, you know, a small kitchenette you guys can use to cook your food before, you know, going on air. And so, you know, we're trying to game plan with our food distributor, like, how are we going to get the food out there? We end up just packing up coolers with, you know, with ice, and just putting them on the plane, because we didn't want to risk the food distributor out in LA not getting the food and not having it not be right, because, you know, we wanted to make sure that everything was perfect, you know, serving the food on air. So, yeah, so we hopped on the plane. We had all of our stuff. Luckily, you know, the ice had held for the short, you know, 2-hour flight from Denver to LA, you know, and then we got there. And the kitchen, I don't even know that you could call it a kitchen. We had these little fryers that we bought from Amazon, and this little flat top griddle. And, you know, we had everything plugged in. There was like a countertop and like one fridge that was full. It was supposed to, I mean, it's what all the producers used to put their lunch in. And that day it was just full of mozzarella sticks and chicken fingers and all sorts of stuff. But so we started cooking. You know, we had the insight knowing that we would probably air and go on at some point around lunchtime. So we had a little bit of a heads up there, but we're cooking. We've got all the stuff plugged in the circuits, the electrical's going out, you know, our producers are running to the back of the set to flip the breakers and get this thing back in line. And they were great. They were helping us drop food and set timers. And, you know, Tom was really adamant. He wanted to make every shark a different fat sandwich. That was his big thing. You know, he wanted to make sure, you know, Mr. Wonderful got a fat donkey lips. And so basically, you know, that was all fine. So we were cooking. And then what happened was the pitch before us, because you never know when it'll end, because sometimes they'll go on for close to an hour. Sometimes it'll be really quick if there's not any deals that get made. But so we were making our food, and they said, hey, you know, you guys got 25 minutes, you know, take your time, you know, make the sandwiches, let's get them wrapped up. But then they came back like a minute or two later saying, hey, you guys are actually on in 5, like, are you ready? And you know, we're like, no, I'm not even close. So, you know, we're making sandwiches, they're grabbing Tom, bringing him out to get him all mic'd up, and then putting Tom back in the kitchen, taking me out to get mic'd up. And it's just this crazy rush. And it's almost like it's just a Friday night at the Shack, and you know, the customers are lined out the door, and it's super busy in the kitchen, and literally all of a sudden we've got our mics on, they're walking us out front, and we're walking down the hallway, and you guys see it from there on TV. And so it all happened so quick. And yeah, it was just a surreal experience for sure. And then obviously you guys were able to see what happened on TV. The entire episode was probably 8 or 10 minutes. I mean, we were in there in the tank for, it had to be at least 30 or 40 minutes, obviously. And then it gets all edited down from there. So yeah, it was an unreal experience. We had a blast up there. Mark Cuban was our number one choice. And so we were happy to see that, especially for, you know, he doesn't always invest in, you know, his main investments in food are usually healthy. So we had the real possibility that, like, you know what, he might not be interested, but we were obviously very fortunate that he was. So
So, you know, at this point now we've got this handshake deal with Mark Cuban. You know, we're leaving the Shark Tank. We're obviously super excited, but we weren't really sure what happened from there. You know, we were in touch with his people, in touch with Mark, you know, and at this point is when they actually do the real due diligence. They start diving into your business, you know, to make sure that, you know, everything you said while you're in the Shark Tank wasn't just a full lie, and they actually want to do do business, you know, with you actually. So at this point now, you know, we're not quite sure what's happening. You know, it's taken time to go through all this process, but, you know, we've just got to keep working. So, you know, in reality, while we aired in September, while we filmed in September of 2018, we actually didn't air, you know, what you guys saw there wasn't aired until May of 2019. So even during that, you know, that period that we're in the, you know, in this kind of holding pattern waiting for Mark to finalize the deal, we just kept pushing, you know. So we ended up opening 3 more locations, you know, in that time frame, and it actually worked out beautifully that the show aired, you know, and everybody in Texas goes crazy for Mark Cuban. We were opening our Fort Worth, Texas store pretty much the week after the show aired, you know. So from what you guys saw, you know, you can imagine, you know, there's millions of people watching Shark Tank. We got hammered with email requests and, you know, people wanting to open Fat Shacks and people wanting more information. So, you know, our back end, we ended up having over 3,000 emails come through, you know, in that first month after we aired, people looking to open Fat Shack franchises. But we're still there just having to do our work, you know. So I think it aired on a Sunday. I was flying out to Fort Worth that following Tuesday to go out there and do the pre-opening, you know, and get ready for the store. So, you know, we're doing stuff in the back, and then I'm sitting at a computer trying to figure out how we're going to answer all these emails, you know, and figure out, you know, how to get back to these people, because we don't want to lose these opportunities, obviously. So it was kind of a really hectic 6 months, you know, after that show aired. But again, we just kind of had our heads down, you know, working, just grinding it out and making sure, you know, that we were going to continue growing the business. So from there, you know, we opened, like I said, we had 14 locations at that point, and then, you know, started getting some of those people from the outside that, you know, found us on Shark Tank that we were wanting to work with. But then again, also still had those people from the inside that we were going to build with, you know, it started as kitchen workers and delivery drivers. So if you fast forward to today, you know, we've now have, as of yesterday, 23 operating Fat Shacks. Kevin is actually in a hotel right now in Topeka, Kansas. They had the grand yesterday. And, you know, if anyone was here early, he was joking around that he's happy to have this webinar so he gets a breather, because you're just checking the sales. They're getting slaughtered right now out there. And we've got another, what is it, 5 stores on the way here that we're working on?
Exactly. Over the next 4 months or so, we'll be opening another 5. And yeah, in Kansas City, Missouri, Plano, Texas, Vegas is on the dockets, one out in Eugene, Oregon. So we've got a bunch on the horizon as well. So
yeah, so we're gonna quickly, Pam, if you want to pull up that that slide, we're gonna quickly just go into some key takeaways from a business perspective for you guys, some things that, you know, we've learned as we've gone, and things, you know, kind of how they relay into our story itself. And then, you know, again, we want to save some time for Q&A, so we'll try to go through this as quickly as possible. But yeah, Kev, if you want to jump in.
Cool. Yeah, so like Tom said, we'll go into each of these a little bit more here in a second. But what we did basically on the key takeaway front, number one is to get creative. Obviously, you heard the story from the very beginning with Tom, you know, starting out of the bagel store. You know, you don't need a lot of money to start a business, which I feel like is, you know, people often think that you do, but you know, if you get creative, you can really find a lot of good ways to make things happen without having that money. And sometimes having a lot of money could hurt your efforts in starting a business. And, you know, most importantly, as you really saw, is that you don't need to be an expert, you know, to open a business or be successful. You know, we obviously didn't have any restaurant. I didn't have any restaurant experience. Tom just had some restaurant experience from the summer prior. So we were not experts by any means, and still really aren't. But if you can be creative and you can be resourceful, you'd be surprised often what you can accomplish. We have just a couple books listed here. I'm big on reading books. You know, there's so much that you can learn. This one here below under the Get Creative is a book called Stretch. This talks about just that, you know, being creative, being resourceful, not needing a lot of money. You know, here's some ways you can think about things differently to get really awesome returns. So that I highly recommend, if you guys haven't read it, to read that one. And then the second one here is be respectful. You know, Tom will go into this a little bit. But basically, yeah, it costs nothing to be respectful to people and, you know, to practice this, but it pays major, major dividends. Could be right away, could be later on, you know, but it's super important to build and utilize your network of friends, And this book here, some of you, this is book has been around forever. And I actually, I heard about this first when I was at TCNJ, somebody had recommended it. And I just can't recommend it enough. It's really an unbelievable book. And, you know, a lot of interpersonal skill building and stuff like that, that really helps, whether it's in business or just in life. So yeah, being respectful is definitely a huge part of what has made us successful.
And then that last section there, effort is key. So, you know, if you guys haven't learned anything about us in the last 30 minutes, I'm sure you can figure that Kevin's a big book reader. But you know, this last one, Grinding It Out by Ray Kroc, this is one of my all-time favorites. You know, this one, this is the book I read. It was in between moving from New Jersey to Colorado, you know, reading about Ray Kroc and building, you know, building the McDonald's empire. I will say, anyone that saw The Founder, they were a little unfair to Ray Kroc in that movie. I say check out the book and hear it from his side, because it's a pretty inspirational story. But, you know, just the effort, grinding it out, you know, really nothing happens overnight. You know, just putting in those hours, putting in those long hours, leading by example, you know, will lead you to building that long-term sustainable business. But yeah, Pam, if you want to, we can get off of the slide now. We'll just kind of talk about a couple stories, you know, in line with these. You know, so that first one, obviously getting creative. I know you all can imagine how that pertains to the Fat Shack story. You know, just graduated college, had about $10,000, you know, getting all these huge quotes to build out a restaurant. You know, rather than trying to figure out what family and friends am I gonna, you know, go beg for money, you know, where am I gonna get this loan from and doing all that, I just, you know, started figuring, hey, I've got this money, you know, I've done this before, let me figure out what kind of resources I can find locally to open this restaurant. And, you know, that was as creative and unique as it can get. You know, there was no space inside of this bagel shop. I used to store food in the college garage. I had box freezers in there. I didn't find out till later that was definitely, you know, not legit in terms of running a business. You kind of do what you need to do in the beginning and you get scrappy, you know, and then you learn this stuff as you go. You know, I also had no money for marketing. So, you know, it was just going to Staples, printing out 1,000, 2,000 black and white menus, starting a Facebook group and just going around and talking to people. You know, I didn't have to have all this money to get that business going. And, you know, to do almost half, I started for about $5,000, to do almost half that in the first night, you know, goes to show you that you really can, you know, start something on a shoestring budget if you have to. And then even, you know, and we've had this theory throughout our growth of the Fat Shack. You know, Kevin and I are super scrappy. As you can see, Kevin's out there, you know, himself still at this grand opening to make sure mm-hmm. that it's going smooth and we don't have to have a whole ton of staff. But, you know, even moving to Fort Collins right away, I started looking for, you know, now I'm looking for my own restaurant space, obviously, because at this point I'm going to start building the Fat Shack as its own standalone brand. And, you know, I found one spot on one side of CSU campus that it was a previous Jamba Juice, but it didn't have a vent hood, which is one of the huge things you need if you're frying and grilling and everything. So I got an initial quote for about $75,000 to put the vent hood in because it was a four-story building and it was just a whole bunch of work. So I quickly, you know, pivoted. I found on the opposite side of campus, it was an Asian restaurant that was about to go out of business who had, you know, a nice 12-foot vent hood sitting in there. So I worked a deal with the Asian restaurant to buy some of their equipment, you know, get them out a little bit early on their lease. And I was actually able to start the entire Fat Shack in Fort Collins for $75,000, which would have been sunk just into that hood. So, you know, getting creative there, you know, and again, Kev, you can jump in too, but.
Yeah, no, and even still to this day, I mean, that's exactly what we do for even these other locations is we'll search for those second generation restaurant spaces, the ones that have the infrastructure in there that could, you know, otherwise is going to cost us $75,000 to $100,000 to put in there. So even to this day, the majority of our stores are always taking over restaurants that were there previously and then putting the Fat Shack, outfitting the space for us moving forward. So yeah, but in general, to Tom's point, yeah, you definitely, you know, get creative. You know, you obviously don't need to be an expert necessarily to get started. You know, a lot of people get scared or they'll wait until they've done all their research or learned as much as possible about an industry, you know, before jumping in. But, you know, instead of waiting 2 or 3 years to open a restaurant or start a franchising corporation, we sort of just went for it and, you know, didn't know everything and, you know, still kind of don't know everything now, but yeah, as long as you're committed to learning along the way and, you know, more importantly, just being flexible when it comes to changing what you're doing, if necessary, or, you know, just constantly improving, then you'll be good. And, you know, we've over the years hired a ton of restaurant people, through the system of the Fat Shack who quite frankly have had you know, much more experienced than Tom and I. And so getting, you know, their experience into our operation and their opinions and how they do things and actually finding out the right way to do things in restaurants was really, really helpful. So yeah, that's definitely a way to do it. So, yeah. Yeah. So the next one too, so yeah, so as it relates to being respectful to people and treating your people really well, like we were saying, it obviously doesn't cost anything, but it, you know, plays huge dividends to you in the long term. I mean, we had, and I don't know, Tom, if you want to jump in with our, with the first store we were looking at in Colorado that had fallen through, and then this other opportunity in Boulder had popped up for us because of a prior contact that Tom actually had from Fort Collins.
Yeah, so, you know, as we were looking for that, for that second full location in Colorado, you know, as Kev said, and, you know, ended up being a Boulder, we had actually had a spot lined up in Greeley, Colorado, which we do have a store there now. You know, it opened a year or a few years later, but we had a spot in Greeley, Colorado that, you know, we 100% thought we were going to get, and then it ended up falling through because they wanted to work with someone that had more experience and, you know, was able to have their second location in Greeley, so they believed that they were going to be a better bet for them. But literally the next day, we got a call about a location in Boulder, Colorado that was potentially available, and it was a pizza shop down there. So, you know, I started talking to the owner, and it turns out that the owner of this pizza shop was actually the same guy that had a delivery company in Fort Collins, Colorado. You know, this was before Uber, before, you know, DoorDash and everything. It was called Hungry Rams at the time. And he was the owner of that. So I actually had a pretty close relationship with him because, you know, we utilized them to facilitate orders for us to do our own delivery. So, you know, we go down to meet with this guy, his name was Jeff. And we come to find out that, you know, he had actually already almost verbally agreed to another party that he was gonna allow them to continue running a pizza shop out of that business. You know, but I just sat there, and Kevin and I sat there with him. We said, listen, Jeff, like, we need the spot. Like, we're not leaving until we make a deal. So let's figure out, you know, how we can figure something out and get this deal closed. And after an hour conversation and figuring out a number and all this stuff, he realized, you know what? I like these guys. I want to help them out. I'm going to sell the spot to them. So we left there, you know, with a deal in hand that we were going to take over the space. Now, you know, as it relates to being respectful, you know, a lot of people, when they're opening a business, they've got multiple vendors and, you know, they think they're the customer. I'm always right. Like, I can treat people, you know, however I want. In this situation, you know, him and I, yeah, there was plenty of issues, of course, with, you know, delivery drivers or, you know, an order not showing up the right way or whatever it may be. But every time I had something, I would come to him respectfully, you know, and have an honest conversation with him and, you know, be friendly and just keep that relationship on really good terms. You know, something like that, if I was one of those other business owners that started yelling at him every time there was an issue with his service or whatever it may have been, you know, I guarantee you that that situation would have ended completely differently. So even though it had nothing to do with the pizza shop we were buying, you know, me treating this guy with respect and our other relationship ends off, you know, ends up paying dividends in the end, obviously. And then, you know, to the same point, when you're dealing with your staff and dealing with people from the inside, like we mentioned, we like to take people and build them up that started as kitchen workers and delivery drivers, you know, build them into franchisees. You know, if we were these guys that were in here being that really harsh boss and yelling at people and treating them poorly, you know, we wouldn't be able to build these teams. So, you know, figuring out how to motivate people, figuring out how to talk to people and, you know, utilizing them to help, you know, not only build your future, but build their future, you know, is a huge portion and something that's, you know, relayed amazingly in that book, obviously, that Kevin mentioned. Yeah. You know, the last thing I'll say on this one too, just another story is, you know, our Boulder store opened, and you know, my thing is always the same idea: treat vendors, treat employees, but also treat all customers with respect, you know, and customer service is one of the biggest things to me, and making amazing quality food and treating people well. You know, we had a customer come in the Boulder location. He was a college student. You know, I gave him the same great service I give every time, made him the Fat Shack sandwich myself. He loved it. And then he reached out to us a month later and wanted to open a Fat Shack. And you know, that guy, his name's Ryan Ginter. He owns 3 Fat Shack franchises now. He, you know, works with us corporately, has been a huge asset to us to build this company. But, you know, again, if he had come in and I was having an off day and just maybe treated him a little poorly or didn't give him that same quality service every single time, we might not have those 3 locations. We might not have this, you know, huge asset on our corporate team.
Yeah, definitely. And then, yeah, just rolling into the third one too, just that effort is truly the differentiator. You switch back just to the entrepreneurship side. And you know, the thing is, these kind of things that, you know, with business, it just takes so much time. Like you read books, you read success stories, and, you know, you learn about them over, you know, just a short period of time. But oftentimes they never tell you just the crazy amount of effort that goes in between. You know, when we tell our story, we talk about, you know, opening the first couple stores and go into detail. Then we, you know, skip to the Shark Tank because that's the, you know, the next big thing that, you know, people love to hear about and know more about. But yeah, in between those first couple stores and the Shark Tank was, I can't even count how many 80 plus hour weeks for 3 years straight that you just don't really, you don't really hear about. But, you know, it's that effort that obviously that pays off, and especially in big moments like the Shark Tank. And, you know, like I said, on TV, you guys see us just for 10 minutes, but, you know, we're in there for 30 or 40 minutes and, you know, the whole time it's just question after question, you know, coming from all angles. And, you know, there was a time or two when Tom was talking with Damon and I was answering a question from Robert, and it's just so much back and forth so quickly. But, you know, not surprisingly, every single question is on topics that, you know, Tom and I talk about every single day, you know, but for both of us to be able to fire back answers like second nature, you know, I believe made a big difference, you know, in situations like the Shark Tank. And you can't get there unless obviously you're just so entrenched in everything that you're doing in every aspect of the business. So yeah, definitely can't discount the amount of effort it takes to get to where you want to go. So
yeah, and that was a huge thing, you know, for me making the leap, especially from Jersey to Colorado, where I know nobody had heard of a fat sandwich. You know, is this going to be successful? What, you know, what's going to happen? I never really worried about that stuff because I knew that no matter what, I was going to be in there working 100 plus hours a week if I needed to. That I was going to do whatever it takes, you know, to make sure it was successful and build this business, you know, and that translated into me in the beginning, you know, sleeping in the store. You know, that opening week, I went in on a Tuesday morning for the grand opening, and I was able to leave on Thursday for about 20 minutes to shower at a friend's house in Fort Collins. But otherwise I was there through the following Monday. You know, I was just sleeping on the couch. I couldn't afford the 25 minute drive back and forth to Loveland. You know, I couldn't waste that sleep because I was in there from 10 a.m., you know, until 5 in the morning. So, you know, I just knew that whatever it is, I'm going to figure it out. If I have to, you know, if I have to be in there 100 or plus hours, I'll do it. And I'm going to make sure this business is successful. So that, you know, helps you kind of get over that hump. And, you know, that's the big thing I want to leave off with before we jump into the Q&A is, you know, Kevin and I are still in this really deep right now. You know, it's awesome sitting here and talking to everybody and talking about the success that we have. You know, and we're proud, obviously, of the Shark Tank experience and having, you know, 23 locations with 5 more coming. You know, we're obviously very proud of all that stuff. But at the same time, you know, we're not sitting on a yacht somewhere relaxing and, you know, enjoying the fruits of our labor. Like Kev's at Topeka right now. When he gets off the pool, he's not going to get a massage. He's going to work, you know, until 4 in the morning tonight, making a bunch of sandwiches. You know, I'm going to be in the Fort Collins store, you know, this Friday night, working all night, training more staff. I'll be out in Topeka next week myself. And, you know, we'll be traveling these stores. So this is something, you know, important to get across here. Well, yeah, this effort is great. And, you know, it's awesome to talk about the success we've had so far. It takes so much time and it just takes, you know, consistency and doing the work, you know, day in, day out to really build these companies. You know, when you look back and, you know, I'm just over 11 years now from the night that I sat in that bagel shop thinking to myself, what have I done? You know, I'm going to be inside of this bagel shop for the rest of my life making sandwiches because nobody knew what they were doing in there. But you just put your head down, you know, you just work day in and day out. And then you fast forward 11 years, you know, we'll have 28 restaurants in the near future. And, you know, we've got a corporate staff of 9 people now and, you know, hundreds of employees throughout all of the Fat Shacks. So, you know, if you just keep doing that, you know, it is crazy how much you can accomplish, you know, if you do this consistently over time. So with that said, you know, we'd love to take some time and answer some questions that anybody has. And I don't know if you want to manage the questions, Pam, or.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you guys. I love hearing that story. This is the second time I've heard it, and I love hearing it just the same. It's a fun story and it's a realistic story, so it's kind of cool for everyone to hear that. Yeah, Kevin, you're definitely not out on a yacht somewhere. Your downtime is volunteering to do this webinar for us.
I'm in a hotel room in Topeka, Kansas, just where I want it to be.
Back to the stretch, we booked that hotel room on Priceline.com and got a great and we're saving that money to open more stores.
Pretty good, yeah.
So keep that in mind.
All right. So one of the first questions I saw in the chat was, how did you come to decide on the name Fat Shack?
So that's actually a funny story because, you know, Phi Kappa Psi and the fraternity is just so ingrained, you know, in the history of Fat Shack. When I was running that business Cars back in 2008, 2009, New Jersey. One of the fraternity brothers actually lived up north and worked for me as a delivery driver. And we were all just kind of sitting around, you know, because it was all established that I was going to move on and do my own thing. And his name's Steve Chikosh. And he gives me a bunch of guff every few years saying, hey, I created the name Fat Shack. Like, you know, when are you going to give me my royalties? So we were sitting around and Steve was just like, dude, the name Fat Shack, like that just sounds awesome. Like, I think you should name this thing Fat Shack. So, you know, again, in my true fashion, I didn't like look anything up or try to run any surveys on what will people think if it's Fat Shack. I thought, you know what? My gut tells me this is a great name. I'm going with Fat Shack. So that was it.
Okay. Michelle has two questions relating to the background of the sandwich itself. Did Rucker, and you saw the one, if the Rucker food truck played part in this? And you mentioned something about the competition between New Jersey and Florida trying to claim fat sandwiches.
Yeah, there's a place called Munchies 420 down in Florida that tries to say that they were the original fat sandwich, but everybody in New Jersey knows that Rucker's, you know, was the original fat sandwich. Me, myself, you know, I try to eat a sandwich at every single place I possibly can. I've probably eaten fat sandwiches at, you know, 20 plus different restaurants that serve them just to test them, you know, especially throughout the country if other places open to do them. But yeah, that's one big thing. You know, when my buddy Rich and I and our friends were starting that business Cars, you know, his older brother actually went to Rutgers. So when we were in high school, you know, we went down there and you're eating this sandwich at 2 a.m. and oh my God, this is the best thing ever. So, you know, in the beginning when we did Cars, you know, we had a few of those fat sandwiches on the menu and that was kind of, you know, where it started. And then I realized quickly that these were the big sellers late at night, you know, so then starting the Fat Shack, obviously I geared more towards those fat sandwiches. Yeah, but that was, you know, that was one thing on the Shark Tank where, you know, they obviously don't show the entire thing. But, you know, we talk about this being a New Jersey thing and, you know, by no means are we out here trying to say that, you know, we started the fat sandwich. For us, you know, it is Jersey, you know, that it is just truly Jersey. And, you know, that's why I wanted to spread this around the country, you know, and with any business, you know, we wanted to do it better and turn it into a quick service and take out instead of just, you know, the grease trucks at Rutgers or, you know, being on a menu in a diner or whatever. It was, hey, let's take this idea, let's utilize it, let's pivot it and turn it into this full, you know, quick service concept and go from there.
Great, thank you. We have another TCNJ related question. During your time at the college, did you ever enter the Mayo business competition?
We did not actually. I remember it going on. Yeah, we never, Tom probably just didn't have anything prepared enough to go on there. So,
you did some of Mayo, didn't you, Kevin? That was all sales stuff actually.
Yeah, no, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know that I've actually, I had.
That was professor. Pelham actually, wasn't it?
Pelham. We did a bunch of stuff on the sales end, but yeah, no Mayo business competition, yeah.
Yeah, and honestly, again, you guys kind of get our personalities just from this last 45 minutes or so. I actually never had a business plan. You know, like when I started the business, I just never had one. It wasn't something that I thought about. It was, for me, it was always just go, go, go. But, you know, that's why I really needed Kevin in there to balance me out because, you know, we couldn't get to this many locations without having that organization on the back end, obviously.
All right. Our next question. Have you ever considered going into stadiums or airports?
We definitely have. It's not necessarily on the roadmap in the near future, but, you know, we've obviously marked, you know, American Airlines Stadium in Dallas, you know, so our thought would be to potentially head there first when and if we do get into that, into that arena. But yeah, generally a more longer term plan for us, I would say, would be the airports and the stadiums. Yeah.
And on the back end too, there's a lot of intricate stuff going on with those business dealings where, you know, they're taking percentages of your rent or you have to franchise it to a certain group that has the rights to the entire airport. You know, so for our model, dealing with these young, scrappy entrepreneurs that are going to go grind it out, you know, it hasn't really fit in just yet. So eventually, but for now, it's a little too crazy to get in there.
Yeah, well, that's a good peek into what may go on behind the scenes in those types of dealings.
Yeah.
All right, let's see. What are the top skills you need to succeed in being an entrepreneur? And also, what advice would you recommend for an introvert like myself, says the submission, who want to be able to build their personal brand and get their name out there during interviews, career fairs, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of entrepreneurship, I would say that grit and drive is the number one. And then another huge one is just staying positive throughout. You know, I talk about this all the time with franchisees. You know, we genuinely try to scare people away before they go and open a Fat Shack, because getting into a business, you know, is a huge deal. And you got to make sure that it's, you know, that it's the right thing for you. But the big thing we tell them is, you know, if you're willing to do whatever it takes and you're willing to work extremely hard, you know, and put your time and your body and all this stuff on the line, you know, then you've got a great chance at making it. But then also, you know, there's kind of the entrepreneurial roller coaster that you hear some people talk about, where, and it happens to us to this day. You know, there's days that I still wake up and I think, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? I should be sitting in an office just relaxing, you know, after 5 p.m., not having to worry about it, because I'm getting a call from somebody that the fryer's broken and this happened, you know, and you're supposed to be spending time hanging out with your wife or, you know, your family. And, you know, so there's those moments where you question, oh my gosh, what am I doing? But then the majority of the time, you know, you sit there and you think, I couldn't have this any other way. You know, I couldn't imagine working for somebody. I couldn't imagine, you know, being tied down like that. And, you know, the beautiful thing about entrepreneurship is that the effort that you put in is what you get out of it. You know, there's nobody there waiting to fire you, or, you know, you have to wait on them for your raise. You know, yeah, there's going to be bad beats. There's going to be things that happen, you know, something might break down and it eats into your profit, whatever it is. But in the end, it's all on you, you know, how well you're going to do. So I love that about entrepreneurship. In terms of getting out there, you know, and putting yourself to build your personal brand, you know, it's something where, for me, you know, I've always loved kind of doing this stuff. You know, I love the presentation side of things. TCNJ, I'll give a plug to the Trend Tones. I don't know if they're still there. I was in the acapella group back in TCNJ. You know, so for me, it was always kind of fun presenting. But then personally, I don't think I've posted on social media in like 4 years or something like that, you know? So, you know, while the business side of it, I love doing this and I love talking about it personally, I'm not a very public person, you know, on social media and all that. So you almost kind of have to be willing to understand that, you know, you're going to turn it on in those certain scenarios, and know that it doesn't mean that your personality, you know, you don't have to be the super outgoing person and this, you know, this crazy person that wants to, you know, post all the time to be able to handle your business the right way and put yourself out there.
Tom, how are you just sharing with us that you were part of the Trentones?
Everybody always asks me to sing a song, and then I say, please, that's crazy. Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
The Fat Shack jingle.
Yeah.
All right, let's see. We have another question. Where are we? I lost my spot. I wrote one down. How did you decide to franchise versus corporate ownership?
Yeah, so for us, the big thing that franchising offers is the ability to grow quick with not a ton of money, because in theory, oftentimes the franchisees are bringing the capital to the table and investing in the spot. You know, we're unique in the sense that we've done many loans internally to some of the people that have worked for us since the beginning, people that started as delivery drivers and kitchen workers that we knew had real promise, but, you know, they just didn't have access to money. So we've set up a lot of those loans. I'm trying to think what was the second part of that question?
Just the franchise versus the corporate ownership.
Oh yeah. Yeah. So basically, yeah,
I think I always kind of had it in my head too, that Ray Kroc book really pushed me into franchising. You know, they were kind of the original company to do the franchising, you know, and I love the idea of having other people be able to build their own success inside of it. You know, knowing that entrepreneurship is such an amazing thing, you know, and even when I wasn't making money back in the beginning in Fort Collins, you know, yeah, you have those days where you're like, what am I doing? But for the most part, you know, yeah, you're working 18 hours and you're tired and you haven't slept, but you still get up and you do it again because you know that you're building something for you, you know, and for your family in the future. So for me, you know, that feeling and the enjoyment of it, I wanted to share that with other people as well. So, you know, to be able to then take a guy that starts as a, you know, back in the day when we did our own deliveries as a delivery driver making $5 an hour, who a bank would literally laugh out of their office if they came in looking for a $100,000 loan, you know, to be able to take that person, help get them the financing through us ourselves personally, and build them into a business owner, you know, that's kind of the really special thing about the Fat Shack for us. You know, we know we're not saving the world one fat thing or anything like that, but to be able to, you know, teach people this entrepreneurship and mentor them and, you know, help them get into their own business. That's the beautiful side of the franchising and why, you know, we're not out there just trying to open a bunch of corporate stores, and we really want to work with people
you know, to get them into their own business.
Yeah, and that's the big thing that drives us just in general, because obviously serving crazy sandwiches in the middle of the night, it's a lot of fun. You know, people love the brand. But yeah, for us, that entrepreneurship element and being able to build people up, you know, from sometimes nothing to being their own boss and owning multiple restaurants. And it's just really cool for us to see and to watch that grow and develop. So
yeah, that's awesome. We have a couple of people, and I'm sure there's more that didn't submit questions, that are asking about your experience working with Mark Cuban. I've always been interested in how the sharks work with companies after the show.
Yeah, for sure. So it's definitely interesting, because we've learned that it's kind of what you want out of it, you know, as a business owner. For us, it was super important that we had autonomy and that we could, you know, do our own thing and run our business the right way. You know, that's part of what's helped us along the way, is we've had the confidence to just know, again, that we're going to do whatever it takes to be successful. Even going into the Shark Tank, we knew, hey, if we don't get a deal, whatever, you know, we'll still keep building this thing. You know, we don't have to have it. It would be nice to have Mark Cuban as a partner, but we don't have to have it. So even then, you know, when we were working the deal, we kind of laid it out that, you know, yeah, we reach out to him for advice, you know, we can reach out to him, you know, if we have a question about stuff, but we have the freedom to kind of do exactly what we want with growing this business and build it our own way. You know, so realistically, I've chatted with a couple other entrepreneurs that have Mark as a partner, and, you know, Mark might be on a Zoom call with them or helping them get a manufacturer, you know, helping them finalize a deal, all that kind of stuff. We haven't had that exact experience with him because, you know, we choose to just keep him updated and, you know, really only reach out if something comes up. But it is amazing to know that we've got him in the background, you know, if we need him, and even just having him as a partner has helped us so much so. And, you know, just growing and building, you know, back in the day, I said, we lost that one space because people wanted more experience. Now people are coming to us. Hey, we want Fat Shack in our shopping center. You know, like, what can we do to get Fat Shack in? So we get better deals, you know, and all these things just kind of snowball down the line to help us build the business. And then in terms of our relationship with him, it is really cool because, you know, we email with him on a weekly or biweekly basis, whenever, just keep him updated. And it is truly him answering his emails. You know, he doesn't have a whole team answering his stuff. And sometimes he'll fire back at us in like less than 2 minutes, just like, awesome, great to hear, good luck, you know, whatever it may be. So, you know, while we did meet with him the one time in person in our Denton, Texas store, just kind of sat there for a couple hours chatting in one of the booths. From there, it's all just been emailing back and forth, and we know that we've got him. But it is pretty cool that, you know, there's this guy worth $4 billion who is on his own emails and just firing back right away. So he must be glued to his phone, you know, and working nonstop.
Well, good to know if any of our audience ever makes it on Shark Tank.
Yep.
And we have a COVID-related question, which is interesting given the times. How COVID has hurt or helped opening and sustaining stores, and assuming that delivery has helped.
Yeah, definitely.
So you want to go, Kevin?
No, go ahead. You start it off. I can.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, we've been extremely fortunate throughout all this. You know, we don't like to boast about it too much because this has obviously been like a devastating thing, you know, not only for everybody personally, but a lot of small businesses and a lot of restaurants. You know, obviously it's kind of decimated a lot of different restaurants, you know, out here in Colorado and all over the country. But for us, we've been extremely lucky that, you know, delivery has always been a huge part of our business. You know, back in New Jersey, when I opened that Fat Shack in the bagel shop, it was almost like one of the original ghost kitchens where nobody even knew where we were. You know, we were just running delivery and people were calling in, and, you know, we were just delivering them that food. So even when I moved to Colorado, you know, it's always still been 50-50, you know, delivery takeout versus dine-in. And a few years ago, you know, we made the pivot to go 100% third-party deliveries. And we kind of saw that the writing on the wall, that why is somebody going to work as a delivery driver for you and have to do dishes at the end of the night and make food when they could work for DoorDash, clock in and out whenever they want, you know, and deliver food at all hours of the night on their own schedule. So we kind of made that decision back in 2018 that we were going to convert, you know, and it played off very well for us when the pandemic hit, because, you know, we already had amazing partnerships worked out with these third parties. You know, we're some of the busiest restaurants on there for these guys. So for us, it was kind of a seamless transition into, you know, a month or so of what's going to happen. Are we going to get shut down? You know, there's kind of that up in the air, you don't know. Again, that positivity comes in where we just know, hey, if it comes down to it and I got to go work 100 hours a week in the store by myself to keep it open, then I'm going to do it. So you kind of have that to lean back on, you know, but luckily with the shift, we were able to transition, you know, and stay really busy and continue opening stores. You know, we've opened, I don't even know how many is it, like 5 or 6 stores in the last 7 stores.
Yeah.
Anything to add to that, Kev, or?
No, that was pretty much, yeah, that's pretty much the whole thing. We had that delivery element to our business since the beginning, and that obviously really helped us, you know, when everybody started going that route, when, you know, you can't really leave the house. So,
and yeah, one more thing on that too, you know, again, kind of keeping it scrappy played into our strengths there as well, because one of those big things, you know, you go in and you find a restaurant space and you're looking, you know, you want to find that corner space with the big windows and draw everybody in. For us, it was, hey, let's look at that bottom line. Let's look at that. You know, what's that rent number? We have to keep it under a certain level. So we're going to negotiate that down. And if we can't get that deal, we're not going to move on that space. So we kind of didn't budge on that. Even after the Shark Tank, you know, I've seen other concepts that get the exposure from Shark Tank. Then they go out and they get the $10,000 a month location, you know, these big spots, because they feel like, hey, we can afford this now. For us, it was keep it scrappy, keep it tight. And, you know, that really played off well for us because, you know, we weren't sitting there paying these huge amounts of rent. Even if, you know, we did dip in sales, these people could have survived on half the sales they were doing because we kept it scrappy. So, you know, just kind of keeping those things throughout, you know, helped us pretty well.
That's great. That's great. And I'll end with this because I saw a few this question floating through the chat a couple times. When are you coming back to New Jersey? When are there any plans to open in New Jersey? I don't know if that's a sign that there's some folks on here that are interested in it.
We would love to get back there ASAP. Yeah, we just, for the very first time, we opened a virtual kitchen out in Philadelphia. What is that, 6 months or? Yeah, about 6 months ago now. So it just does takeout and delivery, and you know, it's been super busy. It's been awesome to get back to the East Coast and close to New Jersey, but we do plan for sure to come back to TCNJ, and and can't wait for that time to be.
We got
to
find that empty spot in Campus Town. You guys let us know when somebody goes out and has that hood. You know what we're looking for now.
Yeah.
That hood vent there, and they're in Campus Town. Yeah, we'll get back in there.
Careful what you say, because there are a few, because of COVID, unfortunately, there are some openings. Yeah. So some people may hold you to that.
Send it our way. Or if we got anybody that still lives in the area and, you know, wants to open their own Fat Shack too. Obviously, like we said, we like the franchising side of it.
So. I'm guessing there's some interest. I'm reading between the chat here. There might be some out
there. Let's get some business students and bring it back. I would love that.
Well, this has been awesome. Thank you guys so much for taking the time to plan this with us and for taking the time right now to present to us and staying on with us as long as you have. So thank you. This is really fun. We wish you all the best in the future. Doesn't sound like you need any luck because it's going so well. Keep grinding. Enjoy Tokyo, Kevin.
Thank you. No, we really appreciate it. Thanks for inviting us on. This is a lot of fun. We love doing stuff like this.
We'll find a way to get you guys back at TCNJ. Maybe we can serve some Fat Shack sandwiches at one of our upcoming events or something.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I'll throw it out there to everybody. You know, you guys know we're super busy, but, you know, my email is literally just tom@fatshack.com. If somebody wants to chat business, wants to open a Fat Shack at TCNJ, you know, whatever it may be, you know, we do our best. It might take me a couple weeks to get back to you, especially during store opening, but, you know, I've chatted with tons of entrepreneurs about their business ideas. And, you know, I truly do love this side of it, and, you know, would be happy to take some emails and, you know, answer anything that I can. So
yeah, I noticed there's a whole section on your website at the bottom that is welcoming the entrepreneurial franchise question spirit. So and I did see a question or a mention of merchandise in the chat, so I just wanted to say that you guys do have a merchandise page on your website that I've already checked out. So if anybody wants
some honey mustard, a Fat Shack shirt, a hat, you know, whatever you want.
Please. I'm a sucker for the stickers. So check it out.
And again, to our point about being scrappy, you're going to put that order in, we're going to get it. And then if Kevin's in town, he's going to fill that order himself. One of our corporate guys will do it. We keep the stuff in our office. So no matter how big we get, again, we try to keep it scrappy, you know, just keep this thing like that. So.
And this webinar was recorded. We'll put it on our website for anyone that needs to reference anything that Kevin or Tom mentioned. And I will do my best to send that PDF as well as your emails, if that's all right, to everyone that registered today. So keep an eye out for that.
Yeah. Thank you guys.
Thank you so much, guys. Appreciate it.
Thanks again, everyone. Stay safe. Thank you.
Bye.